Hello, everyone. Welcome to the press conference at the FCCJ. My name is Teddy Jimbo. I'm a former board member and currently serves as the co-chair of the committee which organizes the press events such as this one. And we have a panel of concerned journalists and a scholar. They are concerned about media freedom. They are concerned that there was a series of intervention by the government of Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, and especially in the recent development where the government officials, including the cabinet minister and the prime minister himself, made a comment regarding the interpretation of the broadcasting law, which is kind of actually unique in Japan. I'm sure they will explain to you the problem there. But anyway, so they will be talking about what's happening in Japanese media today, and what kind of chilling effects the government intervention, recent government intervention, is creating. Let me just introduce the panelists today, speakers. My immediate right is Mr. Mamoru Sakamoto. He's a journalist and he's a former editor of broadcasting industry magazine called Gyarak. And next to him is Mr. Hiroyoshi Sunakawa. He's the associate professor at Rikkyo University. He specializes in the media law. The far right is Mr. Takeharu Watai. I remember him speaking here when he produced a documentary, the Little Bird film. He's a filmmaker and also a journalist as well. And they'll be speaking. Mr. Sakamoto will be actually reading a statement first. Then each of them will be speaking approximately 3 to 5 minutes each. They'll take your questions. Before I forget, of course, our interpreter is always Tamako Takamatsu-san. Takamatsu-san, yoroshiku onegaishimasu. Okay, so please make sure that your cell phone is off. The silent mode or mana mode or whatever. It's off. And there's anything else, let's get the show going. So let's start with Mr. Sakamoto, who will read a statement first.
皆さんこんにちは、坂本です。アピールを読ませていただきます。
By the way, it's kind of a lengthy one, so there should be a translation in front of you in English. He'll be just reading Japanese version of it, and Takamatsu-san will not translate because you have the translation there. There's no sense of her just reading exactly the same thing there anyway. So please take a look at the translation in front of you.
はい。日本語でいきます。放送法の誤った解釈を正し、言論表現の自由を守ることを呼びかけるアピール。テレビ放送に対する政治行政の乱暴で根拠のない圧力が目に余ります。自民党筆頭副幹事長らによる在京テレビ報道局長への効率修正の要請、2014年11月、総務大臣による NHK クローズアップ現代への厳重注意、自民党情報通信戦略調査会による NHK 経営幹部の事情聴取、2015年4月、同党勉強会で相次いだマスコミを懲らしめるには広告収入がなくなるのが一番、経団連に働きかけをといった政治家の発言、6月、政治行政圧力を批判した BPO 放送倫理検証委員会意見書を真摯に受け止めない安倍晋三首相、菅義偉官房長官、谷垣貞一自民党幹事長の発言、11月などです。こうした政治、行政のテレビ放送に対する圧力がテレビの報道を萎縮させ、 人々に多様なものの見方を使えるテレビという表現の場を狭め、日本の言論表現の自由を著しく損なっていると私たちは考えます。特に政治家や行政責任者が日本の放送を規定する放送法の趣旨や意義を正しく理解できず、誤った条文解釈に基づく行動や発言を繰り返していることは大問題です。放送法は第一条で放送全体の不偏不党、真実、自立を保障することを公権力に求め、政治行政の放送への介入を戒めています。放送法は放送による表現の自由を確保することを目的とする法律であり、不偏不党や中立を放送局に求めてはいません。放送法第4条1項2の政治的な公平を番組ごとに要求をしたり、ある番組を放送法第4条違反と決めつけたりすることは全くの誤りです。総理と語るのように首相の一方的な主張を伝える番組も、ある法律に反対するキャスターの一方的な主張を伝える番組も、どちらもテレビに存在してよいのです。その一方だけを放送法違反として排除するのは愚かです。およそ先進的な民主主義国では考えられない錯誤に満ちたマスメディアへの介入によって、自由な民主主義社会を危うくしてはなりません。政治家や行政責任者には表現の自由を謳う放送法を正しく解釈して尊重し、テレビ放送への乱暴で根拠のない圧力を抑制することを強く求めます。政治家や行政責任者は放送が伝える人々の多様な声に耳を傾け、放送を通じて政策を堂々と議論すべきです。テレビやラジオには表現の自由を謳う放送法を尊重して自らを厳しく律し、言論報道機関の原点に立ち戻って民主主義を貫く報道をすることを強く求めます。放送局は圧力を恐れる忖度や自主規制を退け、必要な議論や批判を堂々と伝えるべきです。私たちは放送法の誤った解釈を正し、言論表現の自由を守ることを呼びかけるアピールを通じて、問題の所在を内外のマスメディアに広く訴え、メディア関係者のみならず多くの人々に言論表現の自由について真剣に考え議論をしてほしいと願っています。2015年12月15日ありがとうございました。
Okay, and by the way, the names of those who endorsed the statement that Mr. Sakamoto has just read is also distributed among you, so please take a look at the list if you need names of people who endorsed it. Okay, then Associate Professor Sunaka will be speaking next.
まずあの民主主義国家ではありえないことが今この1年行われているということをあの認識する必要があるんだと思うんですね。
I think the first thing I would like to say is that one should be very aware that something is happening in this democratic society over the past year that should not happen in a democratic society.
ちょうど1年前になりますが、日本で総選挙が行われる前に、政府与党自民党の筆頭副幹事長、ねの名前で、NHK と在京テレビ5社を、まあ、呼びつけて文書を渡すということがありました。
As you may remember, it was a little over a year ago, just before the general elections were being held, that the LDP official, the official title is the chief deputy general secretary of the LDP. He called on the head of the broadcasting department of NHK and also five private television companies in Tokyo, and basically asked them to visit.
公平公正という選挙報道をまあ求めるというものですが、この公平とか公正というのは当然権力を持っている者の側と、それに反対する側とかでは当然基準は違ってくるのが逆言うと当然なんですね。
What the LDP people were asking of the NHK and the private companies was to ensure that the reporting of the upcoming elections be what they said, fair, kohei, and kosei, just. But when we talk about these abstract terms, fair and just, how they are interpreted depends on whether you are speaking from a position of power or whether you are on the opposite side, one without power.
その結果、この自民党の文書要請が聞いたかどうか分かりませんが、昨年の総選挙において、テレビの選挙報道量は格段に減ったという事実がありました。
As a result, I did not know, of course, whether that request, which was given in written form to the heads of all of these broadcasting departments of these companies, was effective or not. I don't know whether that request was honored or not. But we can say, looking back, that the reporting on the elections before that past general election a year ago was much smaller in scope. I mean, there was less reporting than in previous elections.
さらに4月には個別の番組を理由としてテレビ朝日と NHK を自民党が呼びつけるということが起こりました。
Also, I think you may remember that earlier this spring in April, there were two programs that were called into question again by a committee of the LDP. And as a result, persons responsible from NHK and from another private television broadcaster were called to explain themselves and answer questions at a committee meeting of the LDP.
いわゆる先進国ないしは民主主義国と言われているところで、政権与党が個別の番組を理由としてテレビ局を呼びつけるということがあるでしょうか。
So this goes back to what I said at the beginning. I think in every advanced nation of the world, in every developed nation, democratic nation of the world, you would not see something like this occur. What I mean is that in this case, the ruling party basically called the heads of public broadcasters or private broadcasters to come and explain themselves for, so, or justify themselves for specific programs and specific contents.
そういうことをする国というのは多分民主主義国家とは呼べない国家ではないかと思います。
So, I think I can conclude that any nation which allows such activities to take place cannot really be categorized as a truly democratic nation.
こういったものに対して本来は日本の場合は先進国で唯一その免許を放送の監督をしているのが総務省という、まあ、行政なわけですが。
The reason that we have a situation in Japan like this is that Japan is slightly different in the way it is structured. The broadcasters, television broadcasters in Japan, operate according to licenses that are given not by an independent organization, but by a member of, by an organization of the government, specifically the Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communication.
他の諸国では独立行政委員会という、行政と一歩距離を置いた、機関が放送を、まあ、招集しています。
In other advanced nations of the world, the licenses are granted by an independent administrative organization. In other words, a public organization, but slightly separated from the government.
で、本来日本の総務省はこういった自民党に対してこそ行政指導をすべきものです。
In fact, when you truly look at the situation, it becomes very, very clear that the true responsibility of the Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communication is not to provide guidance or to give orders to the broadcasters, but rather to give orders and to give guidance and supervise the workings of the ruling party, specifically the LDP.
その後もこういったような動きが続き、11月には BPO という組織が出した意見書に対して総務大臣、総理大臣から自民党の幹事長が相次いで批判をするというような状況になっています。
However, these kinds of activities have only continued to occur in Japan. As you may know, in November of this year, the BPO, which is the industry organization that oversees the workings or the ethics of the industry, basically produced an opinion paper. And in regard to this opinion paper about a particular case that was brought before them, this opinion paper was publicly criticized not only by the Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communication, but also by the Prime Minister himself and also by the Secretary General of the LDP.
ですから、まあ、こういった非常に異常な状態であるという状況に対して、今回こういった言論表現の自由を守るというアピールをしてですね、政治家それから政府に対して表現の自由の大事さというのを理解してほしいというのが趣旨でございます。
As a result of all of these developments, we here feel very, very strongly that we are in a very, very dangerous situation, that we are in a very worrisome situation. And in order to protect the freedom of expression in Japan, we have chosen to make this public appeal. We are making a request to the government, to the politicians, to respect and honor the freedom of expression principle.
Thank you, Mr. Sanakawa and Mr. Watai.
渡井と申します。私は、まあ、映画監督も名乗っておりますけれども、基本的にこれまで、まあ、放送メディアを通じて、リポートや、特集それから、まあ、映像提供とかで、まあ、実は現在も、まあ、年明けに放送するあの番組、まあ、制作に携わっております。
So my name is Watai, and as was explained earlier, I do have as one of my titles, film director, that is part of my work. But until now, my career has basically been as a member of the media. I have worked on producing reports, special features. I provide visual materials for news programs. And in fact, I am participating in a program, a news related program at the beginning of next year.
まあ、この会見に、まあ、出るにあたってですね、まあ、特にこの2週間ほどですが、放送現場特にニュースの番組に携わっている、記者ディレクターデスクプロデューサーといったような立場の人たちに、今放送現場で、一体どんな政治介入や問題が起きているのか起きてきたかということを、まあ、なるべくたくさんの方に話を聞きました。今日はそのことをちょっと話したいと思います。
So, in preparation for appearing at this press conference today, I've spent the last 2 weeks trying to speak with people in the news media, people who work actually in the field on site as much as possible. Over the past 2 weeks, I've spoke with different reporters, different directors, producers, desk editors, excuse me. And I've been trying to ask people about what kind of political intervention they might sometimes experience or interference they might experience, what kind of problems they faced.
本来放送法というのはこれ、まあ、放送の自由、自主独立を守る法律だと思うんですが、これが、今の、まあ、政権与党からすると何かテレビ放送を監視それから取り締まる法律かのように思われているみたいですね。
When we talk about the broadcasting law, I believe that fundamentally it was designed as a way to ensure that broadcasters would have the freedom to be autonomous and to have freedom to report as they saw fit. In other words, it was a way to protect their rights or their abilities or their work. However, the ruling party currently seems to view the broadcasting law in a very, very different light. They seem to see the broadcasting law as something to, as a tool to use to basically control and monitor and crack down on, if necessary, on broadcasters.
今から10年前にですね、ちょっと詳しい経過を吐きますが、まあ、日本のメディアの方だったらご存知だと思いますが、NHK の ETV 特集改編問題というのが起きました。でその時にやはりこういった場所でいろんなメディア関係者が会見をしたり話したりをしたんですが、私はその時にこう言いました。もし政治家からですね、放送法を守りなさいと、放送法を守った報道をしなさいと言われた時はこう言い返せばいいんじゃないですかと、お前こそ憲法を守れよと、そうやって言い返せばいいんじゃないですかと言いました。
10 years ago, there was an incident involving NHK. The program was called ETV Special Feature. And I think most of you Japanese reporters know the details, and I'm not going to go into them right now. But at that time, there was, again, this question about political intervention by the ruling parties in the activities of media. And as a result, there were many events and press conferences such as this in places such as this. And I was asked to comment. And I was asked if a politician were to come to me and say, you must protect and respect the broadcasting law, how would you respond? And I said, well, the easiest response would be to say, you as a politician must protect and respect the Constitution.
でもし公平中立な報道しなさいと言われたときは逆にこう言い返せばいいんじゃないでしょうかと言いました。あなたこそ公平中立な政治をしなさいと。
And I was asked if a politician were to say to me, you must report in a fair and neutral way, then I would retort or return his remark to him and say that as a politician, you must be fair and neutral as well.
で今その放送現場で特にですね、まあ、今の政権、まあ、与党に対して批判的な、まあ、報道をする番組に対して実はこう政治家だけじゃなくて視聴者からも非常に抗議が寄せられると。でその抗議の内容で一番多いのがですね、偏向報道をやめろ、あるいはさっき言った公平中立な報道をしろといったまあ抗議、まあ、実際には説教のような電話なんですが、それが非常にこう多いということでした。
And I mentioned earlier that I did speak with many people who are working on in the field in the news world, and they say that nowadays, any time that a program basically presents a report that is critical or not in favor of or on the other side of the ruling party's views, it's not just politicians who complain; it is viewers who complain in great numbers, and the viewers and the politicians basically use as their argument that we are doing biased reporting, prejudiced reporting, and they also say you must present fair and neutral reporting. These are not so much complaints that we receive, but basically we receive lectures from our viewers and politicians.
今そのメディアに対して、特にテレビメディアですけれども、その権力に対して、以前だと、まあ、メディアと市民の側が、まあ、同じところに位置したと思うんですが、今権力の側、政治権力の側と、まあ、市民を名乗る人たちですね、そこが一体となって、でそこに、まあ、メディアが対抗していると。でつまりこうメディア、特にテレビがもう権力と市民の側から、まあ、挟み撃ちにあっているというような状態だと思います。
It used to be that in regard to media, and I'm talking primarily about television media, it used to be that civil society, the people, citizens, and the media were on one side, and they were basically looking out and supervising and watching and monitoring the activities of those people in power. In other words, we were on the same side as the people. However, now the geography seems to have changed, and it seems that on the one hand we have media, and then on the one hand we have the people who are in power, and then people who at leaststate that or claim that they are representative of the average citizens. So we find ourselves, the media, basically sandwiched in between the people in power on the one hand, the government, and also on the other hand, people who say that they are citizens.
その権力の側から、あるいは市民を名乗る側からですね、まあ批判を受け続けていると、だんだんとこのテレビメディアの中で微妙な問題、特に政治に関わるテーマ、あるいは政府与党を刺激する内容を扱うことをですね、まあ、避けるこう習慣がこうちょっとずつこう浸透してくるという状態ですね。
And when this kind of situation continues for a long time, in other words, the people on the field are constantly, continuously subjected to criticisms by not only politicians, but people who say that they are representing the average citizen, then the people in the media find themselves over time basically pulling back on some of the things that they do. For example, if they are treating any kind of sensitive topics, particularly a political topic, if they are treating something that might be considered critical of what the ruling parties are doing, then over time this sense of wanting to try to avoid such reporting in its entirety basically begins to permeate the industry.
特にその番組そのものというよりも、一つの項目や一つの VTR の中でも逆の側の意見、あるいは政府の側の言い分みたいなものをですね、まあとりあえず入れとこう、あるいは後でごちゃごちゃ言われるのが嫌だから入れておこう、抗議が来た時のためにのエクスキューズとして入れておこうと、まあそういったようなこう意識でもってですね、VTR を作ったり放送したり、まあそういったまあつまり自主規制、あるいはまあ、先ほどお話してた、これを英語でどう訳したらいいんですいいか分からないですが、忖度ですね、忖度、 これがどんどんどんどんこう内側の制作者の中のスパイラルとしてこう定着してくるというような状態になります。
And over time, this problem or the situation has evolved. And it's not only that one tries to be very careful to avoid criticism for an entire program, but it becomes much more minute, detailed awareness changes. In other words, where you're even doing a feature within a larger program, or you're doing even just one visual section for a program, then... The people on site, in order to avoid being criticized later, or in order to be able to justify themselves later, go ahead and basically preempt themselves, and they put in the opposing view. In other words, if there's a section that's being broadcast that will consider that could be considered critical of the ruling parties, then just to be safe, just in case, they basically put in someone who expresses the opposite view, someone that supports the ruling party's view. In other words, what we're seeing here is a self-censorship that becomes more and more entrenched. And the word that is being used is sontaku, which is a difficult word to translate, but it's basically this idea of trying to second-guess what the ruling parties or the possible critics might want. In other words, to conjecture or surmise what they might want to hear and to provide that in advance to avoid criticism.
そうなってくると、政府与党の側からするとこれはもうテレビに対して弾圧とか圧力ではなくてもういつでも簡単に操作できる自分たちの手のひらの上でですねこうでき何でもこう動かせるというような今状態が少しずつ少しずつこう浸透してきているように思います。
So again, the changes have been very, very subtle, but over time, the situation in the field has changed for news broadcasters. Nowadays, because of the self-censorship, this desire in advance to basically avoid criticism or to basically please people who might eventually criticize the broadcasters means that you have a situation now where the government or the ruling parties do not have to apply pressure, political pressure, to the broadcasters. They can basically manipulate the broadcasters at will. They're basically able to control or supervise them within their own area of control. So that is the kind of situation we're seeing today.
もちろんそういったつまり操作とか弾圧圧力に対してですね、今、意外にといってはなんですけれども、意気盛んなニュース番組のスタッフの人たちもですね、いることもここは強調しておきたいんですが、果たしてそれがですね、こういつまでどうやって保たれるか、あるいは何かの拍子にこう足をすくわれる可能性というのは十分ありますので、私自身はこの政治、特に今の政権与党からのその介入あるいは捜査というものに非常に危惧しております。で、最後に一つだけもうちょっと時間の関係上申し訳ないんですが、この後私が危惧している動き、これは今日本来ここで喋るべきような人と話したんですが、この後に出てくる動きとしては放送法の改正ですね、よりもっと監視取り締まるいうような法律に変えようとする動き、それから、今回のクローズアップ現代のところでも出てきた BPO ですね、 BPO 潰しというような動きが今後、出てくるの、政権の側にですね、政府与党の側に出てくるのではないかということを危惧しております。とりあえず以上です。
So I would, however, not like to present simply a very, very bleak picture of the news media in Japan. There are people still in news media in Japan that are working very, very hard not to bend or to be crushed by the attempts by the ruling parties or the government to manipulate them or to pressure them or to suppress them. There are people who are working very, very hard to fight that. But, however, the situation is becoming very, very severe, and we do not know how long these people will be able to continue expressing their ideas and thoughts. It might be that some incident could occur which would give other people justification to basically drop or eliminate or oust these kinds of people. We have a great sense of crisis and fear and anxiety that these people may not be able to keep on broadcasting as they see fit. So... And again, this is something that goes a little bit beyond just this press conference, but there are movements afoot. There are conversations about the broadcasting law being revised in the near future to make it easier for the government to be able to better supervise, better control, and if necessary, crack down on broadcasters. There's also discussions about this BPO, the industry organization that basically regulates the regulates the industry, to perhaps be eliminated as well. And this has to do very much with the close-up Gendai program, which was an issue that was handled by the BPO, an NHK program.
Thank you, Mr. Watai. And Mr. Sakamoto wants to add just a little comment.
私はこう思います。民主主義というのは、まあ、いろんな意見がある中でだらだらだらだらと話し合いを続けて、なんとか折り合いをつけて物事を決めていく、その手続きそのものなんだと思います。
I would like to just add a few comments. First of all, when we talk about democracy, democracy is not a terribly efficient way of doing things, perhaps. Of the different kinds of governments possible, ways to govern people, this democracy is a way where you, it's a method or a procedure where you have many, many long conversations conducted throughout society. And then over time, as people progress and evolve these discussions, eventually decisions are made.
この話し合いで大事なことは一つは事実を提示すること、それから多様なものの見方を提示することで、これを私たちの社会ではマスメディアが担っているんだと思います。
However, in order to have these different debates and conversations, etc., you need to have two things in society. You need to have two things presented to the people. One are facts, and the other are diverse opinions, diverse viewpoints about these different facts. And in our society, in democratic societies, it is a responsibility or the work of the mass media to present these facts and diverse opinions.
その人々が使っている、まあ、道具ですね、不可欠の道具なんだけれども、これを、奪ったり規制をしたりと。いうことがそもそも根本的な間違いだと私は思っています。
In other words, it is a tool for people in society to be able to understand the world and better understand the issues. But to somehow regulate this tool that is very, very important and often used by the people to regulate and perhaps take away from the people these important tools is something that I think is fundamentally a mistake.
しかも多様な意見をその奪ってしまうとか規制をかけるという時の根拠ですね、理由として、放送法を掲げているんだけれども、その解釈がデタラメで間違ってます。
Not only that, it is at present the broadcasting law that is being used as a justification to basically regulate or take away from the people their right to know diverse opinions and different facts. But I think this kind of reasoning is fundamentally wrong. The interpretation of the broadcasting law is fundamentally wrong.
政治家も行政も、間違っていることをやってはいけない、ダメだというふうに今日は、申し上げに参りました。以上です。
As I mentioned earlier, in my appeal, fundamentally, that is an incorrect interpretation of the broadcasting law, and politicians and the administration government should not do things that are fundamentally wrong. So that is what I would like to say at the very end.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Sakamoto. So we're gonna go to Q&A, and just before so doing, please make sure that you have a copy of the Broadcast Act, Japanese Broadcasting Law, in front of you. What the government is basing their intervention on so-called the fairness doctrines are actually the Article 1, the Clause 2 of the Article 1, and Article 3, and the Clause 2 and 4, partially 4, of the Article 4. So you may want to just keep that in mind. And of course, we have Constitution Article 21, which literally guarantees the freedom of speech and the press, as well as banning the censorship that's in Constitution. Okay, so let's go to Q&A. Let's start with the working press, and then we gradually spread. Okay, Mr. Penn, why don't you start?
Michael Penn of the Shingetsu News Agency. Mr. Watai in his statement mentioned something I think is very true, and that's that there's two forces currently that are trying to shut down debate and criticism. One is coming from official ruling party sources, and the other one coming from unofficial activists who can be very aggressive on social media and in other forums like that, attacking journalists. My question, which I hope that all three of you can give me your answer, because it's something we have a debate among ourselves on this question, what do you think is the relationship between these two forces? Is the ruling party directly orchestrating and supporting these unofficial activists, or do you see these two movements as happening basically separately?
先ほど渡井様の方から板挟みにメディアは今板挟みになっているというお話があったわけでございます、まあ、市民と名乗る方々そしてまた政府与党の関係者でその市民と名乗る方々は我々は非公式のアクティビスト活動家というふうに見ているのでございますが彼たちはその例えばその記者をソーシャルメディアなどを通して批判するわけでございますで私の質問でございますが我々ジャーナリストもこの件についていろいろよく議論するんですがこの公式 の, その批判つまり政府与党の批判とその方たちそしてまた非公式 の, その活動家との関係はどういうものなんでしょうかその与党はその活動家を何らかの形で支援したり何かいろいろ協力してるんでしょうかそれとも全く別々に動いてると思いますでしょうか
誰からいきますかどなたでもまずじゃあ坂本さんどうぞ
基本的にはっきりしたその関係の証拠は、まあ、あまり見つからないんだと思いますね。ただし、政府与党などが強力にその、放送に圧力をかけているそれと同調するような形で同じような主張が新聞に意見広告が載るみたいなことからつながっているのかなというふうに、まあ、見えますね。
We cannot find any direct evidence or proof that these two parties are linked in any way. Having said this, however, when the ruling parties basically bear down publicly very strongly on the media, it seems that almost in tandem there appear many activities by these unofficial activists. They, for example, present huge advertisements in newspapers, presented as opinion advertisements. So because the contents of the two groups are so very similar, one gets the feeling at least, or the impression that they must somehow be connected in some way.
ただ一言だけ言えばやっぱりいろんな意見はあっていいのでいろんな意見広告もそれはあっていいので私たちが根拠としている放送法が間違っていると思ってもそういう意見広告はそれはまあ意見の一つだと思いますから私たちが批判したいのはやっぱり公式なその政府とかオフィシャルなところの間違いを私たちは正していこうと思っています。
But I would like to clarify, even if the advertisements that I mentioned earlier, the opinion page, opinion advertisements that are presented are very, very different from the ideas that we believe in, it's fine because a society is fundamentally a society, a democratic society should be one where there are diverse opinions, and that is one opinion. They should have a right to present their opinions, and we should have a right to present our opinions. Everybody should have a right. What we do, however, wish to point out and strongly request is that the government, the official source, the ruling parties correct their misunderstandings of the situation, for example, their misunderstanding of the broadcasting law, for example.
Okay, Mr. Tanaka.
日本のマスメディアの特徴として今要するに安倍政権を認めるっていうか支持するメディアと、まあ、支持しないというかこれは当然なんですけどメディアとしてちゃんと政権批判するメディアと二分化されてしまっているわけですね。
As you know, when we look at the Japanese mass media today, one of the characteristics that becomes very, very clear is that there's a polarization among the media. On the one hand, you have media that very strongly supports and recognizes, and basically approves of Prime Minister Abe and everything that his administration does. And then there are those who are very, very critical.
この1年間で安倍晋三さんが出演したテレビ局というのはもう限られてしまっています。
I think you're all aware that the kinds of television stations that Prime Minister Abe appears on over the past year, he has very, very much narrowed down the number of television stations that he appears on.
NHK、日本テレビ系列、それからフジテレビ系列。
Basically, he only appears on NHK and on Nihon TV, NTV, and also on Fuji TV stations.
で、ご承知のように日本のマスメディアというのは新聞とテレビが、まあ、系列関係にありますので。
And of course, as you know, in Japan, the newspapers and television stations have a very, very close relationship. They are called keiretsu. They are basically have capital tie-ups.
そうすると日本テレビと読売新聞、フジテレビと産経新聞、それからモミーさんという、ね、あの安倍さんに近い方からやって会長をやってる NHK ってこのグループなわけですね。
And of course, as a result, you know that Nihon TV or NTV is basically supported by the Yomiuri newspaper, and Fuji TV is basically closely associated with the Sankei newspaper group, and NHK is headed by a chairman named Mr. Momii, who everyone knows is very, very close personally to Prime Minister Abe.
11月の14日に、放送法遵守を求める視聴者の会というところが11月14日にはあの産経新聞、15日には読売新聞で全面広告を出しています。
We've been talking about these very, very large opinion papers that are very, very critical of the media. And specifically, I think you all know the one that I'm talking about. There was a huge one-page advertisement presented by a group called group of viewers who want to protect the tenets of the broadcasting law. And this was one that was very, very critical of the media. And this appeared in the Yomiuri newspaper on November 14th. And the following day, excuse me, on the Sankei newspaper on November 14th, and on the following day, on the 15th, in the Yomiuri newspaper.
こういう方、こういうあの、まあ、安倍政権を支持するようなマスメディアの論調と、先ほどご指摘 の、 その非公式な活動家のインターネットで発言しているものが非常に似通っているという傾向があるということだと思います。
So what I'm saying is that this opinion paper was advertisement was put out by people who say they are just unofficial citizens, but they are also the kinds of people that make all sorts of remarks on the internet, again in an unofficial capacity. However, the contents of what they say are basically very, very much in line with what Prime Minister Abe is doing. In other words, they favor him.
あの、私の考えとしてはですね。あの政治に対してもそれからあ、まあ、市民を名乗るグループ、まあ、はっきり言ってこれはもうライトウィング的な右翼的な、まあ、グループなんですけれどもこれはどちらともあの距離をあの置くべきだというふうに思っております。
My thinking is that when we look at these two groups, the politicians groups and the people who call themselves basically people, just average citizens, but I think we all understand that they lean very much toward the conservative camp, we can call them right-wing groups. I think it is very, very important for media to step away and keep a good distance from both groups.
あの、まあ、これも公平中立、公平とは何か中立とは何かという問題にも関わるんですが、あのこれは以前にもある方が言ってましたけれどもこう放送における公平中立っていうのは、右とか左からの中間点とか公平さを保つことではなくていかなる政治にも経済界にも支配されない干渉されない影響されないという、まあ、自主自立の確保それが放送における、まあ、あの公平、中立ではないかと。ということを指摘されてましたが、あのまさにそうだと思います。
Quite often these days when we talk about broadcasting and media, the words that are quite often used is this kohei, which means fair, and chūritsu, which means neutral. Again, these are abstract words, and what actually do they mean? Someone once said, and I like this definition very, very much, is that in terms of the broadcasting law, when you talk about being fair and neutral, that does not mean that you stand in the midpoint way between the right-wingers and the left-wingers. That is not what being fair or neutral means. It means that regardless of the people that might be in power, whether they are in politicians, whether they are people in the business world, the media must retain its autonomy, its independence. It must be not bow allow interference or intervention by any group. It must always maintain its independence and autonomy.
Okay, next question. Okay, go ahead.
Siegfried Knittel, writing for Austrian newspaper, The Standard. It's not for Mr. Watai. You talked about self-censorship. It's not a problem if it's self-censorship, that media, a lot of media, the liberal media, feel a bit isolated in the society. There is no public support for the media. So in this way, they feel weak. It's not a problem in Japan that the public is not protesting against this broadcasting law. If you think about paragraph 9 in the summer and about the Chiedai, there was a lot of protest, but not about the freedom of the press. It's the idea of the freedom of the press. Does the public not understand what it means or why? What's the reason for that? That is no public outcry in this case.
さっきも大谷さんもおっしゃったのでございますが、その今メディアはその自主規制を行っているということでだったのでございますが、私が見ますと、日本のメディアの関係者というのは、孤立、社会の中で孤立しているというふうに感じているんじゃないんでしょうか。つまり、公っていうのか、一般市民からの大きなサポートを得てないというような不安があって、非常に弱い立場にいるというふうに感じているんじゃないかと思うんでございます。つまり、一番大きな問題というのは、その社会、一般市民がこれにおいて立ち上がらないからということではないでしょうか。例えばこの夏、救助についてとかいろんな法案とかについて大きなその運動があったわけでございますが、メディア その自由、ということになりますと一般市民はあまり何も言わないということでございます。これはなぜなんでしょうか。彼らたちはこの、原則というものをあまりよく理解してないんでしょうか。
はい、私は大学の教員ですので、学生と向き合っています。
I am a university professor, so I speak with young people, students all the time.
そうすると、日本の学生っていうのは、メディアをこうけなすことはするんですけど、褒めるっていうことを経験してないんですね。
And it's a very odd thing, but Japanese students, while they have seen and often participated in themselves criticizing media, they have never experienced or seen people actually praising the media. So they don't know how to praise the media.
ですから学生とかそれから大学でも市民講座といって一般の市民の方が出るような講座の時にどうやってメディアを支えたらいいですかって質問に対していつも答えているのが。いい番組ですとかいい記事の時にはどんどんこう褒めることをやりましょうとそういうことを言っています。でそれは実際ここに今日日本のメディアの記者の人いますけれども今苦笑されている方も何人かいらっしゃいますが本当にそういうもの支えがないんですよ。
So I tell my students, and not only my students, but also we have classes that are offered to the general public as well. And when I speak before them, sometimes this question comes up. Then how can we support the media? How can the average citizen support the media? I say to them, if you read a good article, if you read a good article, or if you see a good program, then speak up and express praise for that article or program. That's the best way to support them. And I think there are many people of the Japanese media here today who will understand very well what I'm saying.
したがってそういう意味では日本の社会で、メディアの重要性とかを理解していないということであるのかもしれないですけれどもこういうような、今日の会見も含めてこういう状況の中でやはりこうメディアっていうのは大事だっていうのは再認識されるでしかもいいやっぱりこの社会にとってメディア必要なんだっていうものに対しては褒めていくっていうことがこれから重要なテーマなんだというふうに思っています。
So, as you've pointed out, perhaps it has been that the Japanese society, average citizen, has not realized how important the media is and don't really understand how vital it is for a nation. However, through various activities, for example, including this press conference, I hope this will be an opportunity for the society to become reaware of the importance of the media to society. So, please, I would like to encourage anyone. Who's out there to praise the media whenever you can have an opportunity?
Okay.
Go ahead. ちょっと追加します。日本人というのは本当にテレビが好きです。ものすごく好きだと思います。見てる時間も長いし、テレビを信頼しているかどうかという質問をすると、 断トツで日本の NHK 信頼度が世界的にも高いんだと思います。
I would also like to point out that Japanese people love television. The numbers of hours the average person watches is very, very high compared to other nations. And when you ask people if they basically trust what they are watching, the trust that people place on NHK reports is very, very high, some of the highest trust or figures that we see even in the world.
で、実際、テレビで楽しんだり笑ったり泣いたりということは非常に大きいと思いますけれども、私はそれは日本に昔からある井戸端会議って言葉がありますけど、みんなでペチャクチャ狭い世界で喋ってる、その大事なツールの一つなんだろうとは思います。
And I think one of the reasons that Japanese people like watching television so much is that it's basically an extension of something that was in Japan for centuries and centuries. And that is basically what we call Irobata Kaigi, meaning that you have conversations around the village well. And this is a way where you can exchange opinions and gather information. And it's, of course, Japan has always been kind of an closed off society. And that's how you basically affect communication within that small enclosed society. And I think TV now serves as that tool.
ただ話題が一転して固くなって、例えば安全保障の問題であるとか、税金をどうするとか、国の財政はどうなのかとか、あるいは沖縄の問題とか、こういうものはやっぱり非常に関心が薄いんですね。テレビの人が言います。沖縄をやると視聴率がガタッと落ちるって言いますね。
Having said this, however, although there are many, many conversations and people love to watch television and laugh and cry and basically enjoy what's happening on TV, when the topic becomes serious, when you're talking about issues that have to do with taxes, with the fiscal situation of the government, with the Okinawa problem, with security issues, the average person loses interest very, very quickly. Even people working in the news media in Japan say that when they present something on Okinawa, they know already that they're going to lose viewership, but they still go ahead and broadcast it.
やはり私は日本人っていうのはこの社会を自分の力で作っていくとか、そういった機能というかな、そういう力があるんだよというところは弱いんだと思う。自覚があまりないので、例えば長いものに巻かれろみたいな、あるいは弱らば胎児の影なんて言葉もありますけれども、そういった日本人のなんていうかな、心根がやっぱり現れてるんじゃないかと、そんなふうに思いますね。
And I think it comes down to something that perhaps a sociologist might explain as being part of the Japanese character, that Japanese people do not have a fundamental basic understanding or comprehension or an awareness that it is they themselves as individuals that create society, that they actually have this function and that they have this capacity and ability to actually create society. There are many, many things, phrases that have been around in Japan for a long, long time, but basically ideas that if there are things that are very large movements, then you just keep your head down and just go along with the flow. Basically, even if you're unsatisfied with something that's happening, you just basically endure, and over the long term, things will more or less work out. I think the lack of interest in serious issues and serious debates is a reflection of Japanese history.
Okay, next question. Okay, Joel.
Hello, Joël Legendre from RTL France Radio and TV5 Monde. Recently, there was an issue where the UN representative to the Freedom of Expression Committee was supposed to come to Tokyo. And he was asked by Japan not to come, if I remember well. And if that's factually correct, so please, I'd like to ask you, Japan doesn't like the media who are critical. I rephrase it. Japanese administration of Mr. Abe doesn't seem to like the media who are a bit critical and targets personalities such as Kuniya from NHK, who is a very competent journalist, or Kishi, who is also a very competent journalist and a long-time writer on the Mainichi and TBS. And those personalities have their strength. Okay, but nevertheless, when I look at the Japanese press from a foreign viewpoint,My question is it able to fight back? Is Japan media in the situation that you presented capable to fight back? Do they have the weapons for that? Remember the Nagano Olympics, the scandals about Tsutsumi. the Japanese media haven't mentioned things about that much. We had same issues with the FIFA. Japanese media said nothing about it. So my question is rather, have the media in Japan the capability to be extremely powerful in their answers as we have in UK or in France to the point to die, Charlie Hebdo, for our viewpoints, for our opinions, for our comments, for our news reporting. So have the Japanese media this capacity? What do you forecast for the future? Thank you.
はい、最近、ごめんなさい、細かいことは覚えてないんでございますが、国連 の、 その、その代表者が日本に来て、その日本 の、 その表現の自由の状況についてその調べるということになってたんですけれど、日本国政府の方からちょっとその延期、まあ、来ないでくださいという話があったと思うんでございますが、それについてどう思いますでしょうか。で、その延長なんでございますが、私が見ますと、やっぱり今の政府、特にその安倍政権、安倍さん自身はあんまりその批判するメディアとか批判する人っていうのは好きじゃないようでございます。もちろんそれに戦うような強い人物も時々いるわけでございます。例えばその TBS 毎日で活躍してきております岸井さんなども非常に意見をはっきり言う方でございますが、ただ、数が少ないように感じるわけなんでございます。まあ、外国メディアから見ますと、日本のメディアっていうのは本当にその戦い回数だけの強さ、能力っていうのを有してるんでございますでしょうか。例えばでございますが、長野オリンピックの時に堤さんのお話がいろいろ、まあ取り沙汰されたわけでございますし、この前では FIFA のスキャンダルなどがいろいろ、取り上げられているんでございますが、やっぱり日本のメディアはそんなに大きく追及してないという感じがするわけでございます。まあ、英国、あるいはフランスではまあ、チャーリー・ヘベドのようにその自分たちの信念のためにもう命を捧げるというぐらい、もう本当に戦う精神、そして戦う能力というのを持っているわけでございますが、日本のプレスはどうなんでしょうか。そういう能力、力、そしてその、まあ、覚悟というのはあると思いますでしょうか。そして将来的にはどうなるでしょうか。
ちょっとまず2つ目の質問の方ですけれども、基本的に先ほどの質問も出てましたが、なかなかこう戦う記者ディレクターの人たちはいるんですけれども、その人たちが、こう社内でなかなか力を持ったポジションにいない、権限を持つところにいないという現状がまず一つあります。
I'd like to begin by answering your second question. And this has to do with something that I said earlier. There are people in the field, there are directors and there are reporters who are willing to fight and who have great resolve. However, unfortunately, in most of their cases, they are not within their respective organizations or companies in positions of great authority or power.
したがってそうした人たちが取材するテーマみたいなものがなかなか上がってこない。やりたいと思っていてもそれが出ない。という現状があり、そしてまあ一番これ問題なのはやっぱり局内ですね、つまり会社内での駆け引きといいましょうか、まあ、つまり足を引っ張る人たちがいると。ですから私はまあよく言うんですが、テレビの場合政治介入よりも政治部介入、まあこれがこれまでずっと横行してきました。あるいは政治部に近い人たち、今の政権に近い人たちですね。でもこれがまあもちろん政治部だけじゃなくて報道局長だったりとか編成局長だったりとか、その近くの人という場合もあるんですけれども、そういった人たちのこう意向に沿わないテーマ、先ほど言いましたがだんだんとこう避けていく、やらなくなっていく、まあ忖度していくといったような状態にあると思います。
However, because these people are who do want to fight back and who do have an idea of the kinds of stories that they feel the public should know about, because they're not in positions of power, even though they try to pursue certain themes, they're hardly ever taken up by the programs that they work for. And separately from this, and I think this is even a larger issue and more important issue, is that it's that you have these kinds of give and take kind of political sort of maneuverings within the company or within the particular department within a company. In other words, people try to basically compete with other people for better positions, better jobs. So quite often they describe the situation as saying, as being that people on site who want to present certain views, it's not that they have to worry about political intervention from the government or politicians, but they have to worry more about interventions by the political department within their company. And it's not the people who work in the political department, of course, want to be close to the government and politicians, and they sometimes get in the way. And it's not just people in the political departments of these companies. Sometimes it is people who are close to the programming division head or the broadcast news division head. Again, there is this situation that is growing more and more in Japan where people on site, even if they're not told specifically you cannot do this or you must do this, they begin to sense over time that they understand what it is that their superiors or people in power within their company might want or might disagree with, and they try to make preemptive decisions, basically self-censorship themselves, and they try to make decisions that they think will be pleasing to their superiors. And that's a very, very worrisome situation.
以前だとそういった局内の駆け引きやそういった関係性を超えてですね、読者や視聴者がサポート支持していればその人の発表するテーマや取材することができたんですけれども、今とにかく日本のこれは全体の会社ですね、全体組織としていますけど、抗議や批判に非常に弱くなりました。いくら応援する人たちが周りでいたとしても、抗議とか批判がたくさん寄せられたときに、それを回避する、揉め事を避ける、対立を避けると、そういった形でどんどん自ら自主規制、自己検閲してしまうようなスパイラルにあると思います。以上です。
And I think in the past, it might have been that if there was strong support from the viewership, the readership, or from the public, then people with strong opinions would be able to overcome these internal dealings or maneuverings within the company and still be able to present the kinds of reports that they felt society wanted. However, and I've been talking about the Japanese media and how there's kind of this self-censorship or this sense of trying to basically avoid confrontations or avoid criticisms at all costs. But it is not just simply the broadcast media that I'm talking about. I think there's this tendency among all Japanese organizations or companies nowadays. They are very, very weak when it comes to being criticized or being attacked or receiving protests. Even if there are people who support them publicly, if they face any kind of criticisms at all, they immediately crumble. And I think as a result, people in all large corporations and organizations now want to do their very best to avoid confrontations or criticisms in advance.
Just to follow up Joel's point, he asked the weapons that Japanese media might or might not have. But since we have an expert on broadcasting law, Mr. Sanakawa, I just want to ask a follow-up question. What about the weaknesses? Why Japanese media are so weak against the government? I mean, government can, intervene, say anything they want to, but they don't have to, abide by that. I mean, they can just, ignore it. But for some reason, Japanese broadcasters have to take any words from the government very seriously. And that's one of the wonders of Japanese broadcasting. So that's one. And at the same time, newspapers, I guess that has something to do with the cross-ownership system. But newspapers should be free to talk about anything. But for some reason, they don't protect, the freedom of the press when it comes to the broadcasting. Is there any weaknesses for the newspapers as well? Just today or yesterday, there was a news on the reduced tax rate for the newspapers. It's only food, the groceries, and newspapers are subject to tax exempt. And I haven't heard any TV commentator complaining about this. Why newspaper of all the things, medical, everything else is going to be taxed on 10%. Newspapers are going to be taxed only 8% along with the food. So including that, if Mr. Sanakawa, if you can just clear up our questions about the broadcasting license system and cross-ownership. Thank you.
そうですね、先ほどの質問では日本のメディアはどのようなツールを持って、政府とかを批判する、圧力をかけるような人たちに戦えるかという質問があったんですけど、逆にその、関連する質問などございますが、特にその砂川さん、この分野の専門家でいらっしゃるわけでございますので、日本のメディア その、弱さはどこから来るのでございますでしょうか。つまり政府とか与党が、いろいろ批判してもそれは勝手だと思うのでございますが、それになぜそんなに日本その放送事業者はそんなに弱いんでしょうか。そしてまたテレビだけではなくその新聞の方でも同じことを言えるのではないかと思います。これはやっぱりその系列というような関係があるかもしれませんが、資本関係のことがあるかもしれませんが、とりあえずその放送法等は関係なくその新聞は自由に物事を言えるはずわけでございますが、しかしながら新聞もあんまりその表現の自由、メディアの自由ということはあんまり歌わないわけでございます。昨日その軽減税率の話が出たわけでございますが、食料品と新聞だけが軽減税率の対象になるということでございます。でもこれについて誰もそのテレビ関係の方たち、テレビ番組は言わないわけでございます。批判しないわけでございます。もう軽減税率の対象であるべきものって他にたくさんあるはずだったと思うんでございます。例えば医療費とかもっともっと、そのあると思うんですけど、なぜ食料品と新聞なんでしょうか。放送法を含めて、どこにその日本のその放送事業者の弱さがあるかについてお話しできます、いただけますでしょうか。
日本のその放送法ってのは1950年にできた法律です。
Excuse me, the broadcasting law in Japan was established in
1950. 1959年に法律ではなくて、郵政省の規則なんですけれども、マスメディア集中排除原則というのができました。
In 1959, this is not a law, but this was a principle that was established by the Ministry of Posts and Communications, which is now the Ministry of Internal Affairs and Communications. In 1959, and a direct translation would be this principle of concentrated elimination or ousting of mass media, mass communication.
It's basically an anti-monopoly law for media.
ごめんなさい。
テレビと新聞とラジオを一人の人が持っちゃいけないっていう、そういう規則です。
In other words, it was a fundamental idea that one single entity could not own both television station and newspaper and radio station.
ただこの規則には抜け道がありました。
But there are many loopholes.
その地域で独占の度合いがなければ大丈夫だという。
And one of the loopholes was that if in a particular area this entity did not hold the majority market share in that area, then they would be exempted from this anti-monopoly law.
この適用を受けたのが富士産経グループなんですね。
And this exemption was actually used by the Fuji Sankei Group.
産経新聞、フジテレビ、日本放送という、これは東京は情報が集中してないから政府だっていうことになったんですね。
The reason that the same entity was able to hold both the Sankei newspaper, the Fuji television, and also and also the Fuji group, and also the 日本放送ですね。
ラジオ。
Sorry, this is the radio station, Nippon Hoso Broadcasting, was because that they did not have a majority in the Tokyo area.
このだから除外にももうすでに政治が非常に深くコミットしているわけですね。
But the fact that this exemption was made for this group in 1959 for this principle means that even at that time, political intervention was already present.
で、それから1975年、これが新聞とテレビを資本関係を整理をしたんですが、それは田中角栄さんという方が主導してやられています。
In 1975, there was another big development in the mass media world, and that was that the capital relationship, the capital tie-in relationship between newspapers and television stations was going to be reviewed and reorganized. This reorganizing process was overseen by a man named Mr. Kakue Tanaka.
つまり自民党の長期政権の中で新聞とテレビと自民党というものが 非常にこう強く結びついているのがこの国のメディアの現実ですね。
In other words, you can see by these two examples that I've given you that over the long history of in post-war Japan, there has developed between the three organizations, newspapers, television and stations, and the LDP, an extremely deep and strong relationship, of strong and deep ties.
したがってテレビが政治に対してものを言わないことがイコールその新聞ともまあつながってきているということになります。
In other words, we have seen that over time this has developed into a situation where television basically does not criticize politicians, and that has also basically led to newspapers also not criticizing politicians.
現実に一つエピソードを申し上げれば、私がある新聞から取材を受けた際に安倍政権を批判しました。
Just to give you an example, I received a request for an interview by a specific newspaper, and I was very, very critical of the administration, Prime Minister Abe's administration in my interview.
そうしましたところ、その記者は、うちの新聞社は社論として軽減税率を求めているので、新聞への軽減税率を求めているので、安倍政権は批判しないでくれと、そういう記者がいました。
During the interview, however, the reporter that was interviewing me said, please, sir, you must understand that it is company policy that we are wanting to do everything we can to ensure that we will be exempted from the tax increase. In other words, newspapers will be exempted from the tax increase. And as a result, we have taken make it basically a company policy or understanding not to be critical of Prime Minister Abe. So please stop criticizing Mr. Abe.
したがってその新聞には私のコメントは載りませんでした。
As a result, even though I continue with my comments, my comments critical of Prime Minister Abe did not appear in that final article.
一言だけ補足させてください。日本のメディアのジャーナリストとか記者は、ジャーナリストや記者である前に会社員です。これが日本のメディアが弱い、私は最大の理由の一つだと思います。
I would also like to add that I think the greatest weakness with the Japanese media is that when you talk about journalists, when you talk about Japanese media, before they are journalists, before they are members of the media, the most important thing that is even more basic to their existence is that they are company employees. And that position or that status makes them weak.
One thing I want to say.さっき、まあ、これは雇用の形態にも多分よると思うんですけど、多分海外メディアの方はその自分が所属している会社と契約を結んでいるという感覚が強いんじゃないかと思うんですね。で、日本の場合は契約を結んでいるというよりも雇用されているというふうに多分思っている人たちがほとんどなので、もうこの辺の意識として根本的に違うだろうと。しかしやっぱり放送メディアはやっぱり民主主義 の根幹ですし、もう情報ライフラインの最も重要なところだと思いますから、やっぱり放送メディアに携わる人は基本的にはみんな僕はジャーナリストだと思ってますし、ジャーナリストとしての価値判断とか公共性、社会性、重要性、それでもって何を伝えるかどう伝えるかということを優先させるべきことだと思うんですが、それがなかなか現状として、なってないということだと思います。
I think what was just mentioned about the employment system being very, very different for journalists in Japan, I think is truly a source of great weakness for the Japanese media. In other words, I think for most members of the foreign media, you belong to different companies, but you probably have some kind of an employment contract with these different companies. Whereas in Japan, it's not so much that people think of themselves as contract employees, but they think of themselves as direct employees belonging to that company basically forever. And I think that is a fundamental difference in self-awareness.Awareness. Having said this, however, I think that when we talk about broadcast media, I believe that more journalists fundamentally should understand that before they are company employees, they are journalists, and journalists are an important foundation for society. They are perhaps the most important foundation for ensuring that democracy continues to thrive. And it is on the basis of being journalists that they should make decisions as to what they will report on. coming from the viewpoint of a journalist should determine their values. It should determine whether how they choose stories based on public interest, on how important it is to society. These are the values that should be kept uppermost in journalists' minds. However, of course, I'm talking about ideology or something that's idealistic and maybe not necessarily always reflective of the truth.
Thank you. We have three more questions lined up. We have till 3:30, so I think we can handle all. Okay, let's go with Watanabe Haruka-san first, then Fujita-san, and then the last one. With
Thank you. Haruka Watanabe, HKW, Media Report to Women. 日本語でしっかり答えてほしいので、日本語で質問します。先ほど和田井さんが政治問題じゃなくて社内の政治部問題だ、政治部の介入問題だということをおっしゃいましたが、そうでしたらどうして外国記者クラブじゃなくて国内の日本記者クラブで会見をされないんですか。それとも日本の記者クラブで却下されたのでうちに逃げ込まれたんですか。プレスクラブはもう今年で70年、私はそのうちの35年メンバーでずっと見ているんですが、何かこう問題があるとここの日本外国特派員協会に逃げ込まれると。でもし自主的に自分たちで戦うという決意があるんでしたら、日本のメジャーのメディアの人を味方につけて日本記者クラブで会見するとか、そういうことをなさればいいんじゃないでしょうか。先ほど支持者のリストを拝見したんですが、どちらかというと富士山の中から上じゃなくて裾野のあるような方が賛同されています。そこに日本のメディアが報道の自由、プレスフリーダム・オブ・ザ・プレスを確立する弱さがないんじゃないでしょうか。もう少し覚悟を持ってしっかり戦ってください。コメントと質問です。
So you mentioned earlier, excuse me, I want to ask my question in Japanese because I want to have a very solid answer in Japanese. You mentioned earlier that the biggest problem faced by Japanese media was not political pressure from the government ruling parties, but rather the inter-company warfare or dealings, pressures within the company. If that is truly your feeling, then why don't you have a stronger resolve to go out and fight and make sure that all of the press, Japanese press media, are very much on your side? In other words, what I'm asking is, why are you holding this press conference here at the FCCJ and not at the Japan National Press Club? Because if you were giving a press conference at the Japan National Press Club, then you would be able to basically get all of the Japanese media on your side, and you would have a much stronger position in which to conduct your battles. I've been this press club has been in existence for 70 years. I've been a member for 35 years, and it's been my observation that quite often when there's a problem by a group and they cannot get the attention of the Japan press, so they come here asking for help. But if you're really truly resolved to try to fight this battle, then I think you need the support of the press, Japanese press, and you need the strong press, the support of people powerful within the Japanese press. I've looked at a list of your supporters, and to be very honest, they're not the people who are on the top part of Mount Fuji, but are kind of on the foothills of the mountain. In other words, they're not the really strong people in media that you need to get behind you. It's fine that you've come here. Were you just simply turned down by the Japan National Press Club? It's fine that you've come here. But I think that on behalf of Japanese media, you have to truly fight a stronger fight and get the support of strong people.
Sorry, she also
said yep. Mm.そうですね。だから却下されたんでしょうか、日本記者クラブで。
いや、
できたんでしょうか。
例えば私は同じような記者会見を去年1年前にやりました。11月、12月の1年前ですね。11月に自民党がテレビに圧力をかけた、報道の責任者を呼びつけて、公正中立にやってくれと言ったときに、テレビが非常にビビっているので、私などが声をかけをして、これは国会の記者会、なんだっけ、
国会議員会館
の部屋を借りて、記者会見をやったことがあります。その時にもアピールは出しました。
So actually, we have also given similar press conferences for the Japanese media as well. A year ago in December, we gave a press conference, and this was immediately in response to what happened in November when the members of the LDP basically put political pressure on some television stations and requested or demanded that the people responsible in several different television companies come and explain themselves, and they were told very strongly to provide fair reporting. And in regard to this action by the LDP, television stations, basically broadcasters, are very, very reluctant or very frightened to complain. And so we decided we had to take the initiative. And we held a press conference, not at the Japan National Press Club, but within the Diet, excuse me, Representatives Building. We reserved a room and held a press conference there.
1年前の会見には、発起人に岸井さんが入っていました。それから田原総一郎という人も来ました。
I would also like to announce that at the time of the people who were involved in establishing the organization that held the press meeting, Mr. Kishi, the reporter from TBS that was mentioned earlier, and also Mr. Soichiro Tahara, a very respected journalist, was also a member of those.
今回は別に私は外国特派員協会に逃げ込んだつもりは全くなくて、ここは新しいのでここでやったらどうかと思っただけのことですが、同じような誰でも知っているようなキャスターなどには声をかけてここに並んでくれとも頼んでますが、今はもう出られないと思います。
And this time, you mentioned that you thought that we might have been turned down by the Japanese media places for Japanese press, to hold a Japanese press conference, and we had basically come here seeking some kind of protection or sanctuary or some kind of refuge. But I do not think of this press conference as being anything like that at all. This is my first time here, and I thought it was a new approach, an expanded approach that we were taking. And to be honest, we did ask a very famous newscaster to also attend the press conference here and sit by us, but we were told that he could not attend this time.
一言だけ、1年前の記者会見の時に岸井さんは発起人に入ってくれたんですが、田原総一郎氏は発起人に入ると朝まで生テレビが潰れるかもしれないと言いました。
Actually, a year ago, Mr. Kishi, the TBS journalist, did put his name out, put his name down as one of the founders or establishers of this organization to hold this press conference. But Mr. Soichiro Tahara decided that he could not list himself as one of the founders or main members because he said that if he did so, his television Asahi program, which was a debate program that's held and debating different social issues during very late hours of the night, he said that that program might be endangered.
テレビはかなり追い込まれてきていると私は思っています。名前も出せないですね。署名もできないと思いますね。
So I think this is an indication of how difficult a situation many people working in the media find themselves in Japan today, that they cannot speak up and even give their name, not even attend a press conference, but they cannot even put out their name as supporting something that they believe in.
Okay, we have two more questions. Can Manaru? We have two more questions. Can you all stay maybe just a little extra time? 5分か10分ぐらいいいですか、少し過ぎても。渡井さんもし今のでコメントがじゃああれば言ってください。
今の件で言うと、本来ならばこういったところよりもまずは局の中でですね、やっぱり集会とか特に労組ですね、で今までまあいろんな放送、これはちょっともう本当砂川さんがいるところのメディア総研はちょっと手前味噌になるかもしれませんが、何か放送業界で問題が起きたときにいつもまあ私はこれを見てですね、過去どんなことが起きたか、それから過去どういう戦い方をしてたかということのまあ参考にまあいつもこれを見るんですが、やっぱり1960年代70年代ぐらいも政治介入っていっぱい起きてますけど、やっぱりまず局の中にいる記者ディレクター、あるいは労組ですね、そこが非常に立ち向かった、負けたかもしれないけれども少なくとももう戦った痕跡はありますし、そういった時代があった。ところが今なかなかこう、まあ、NHK の例えば日報論も含めてですけど、外での集会とかですね、あるいは市民と一緒に話すとか、そういったことを本当にやらなくなって、で内側にこもって、先ほどじゃないですが攻撃されるかもしれない、あるいはこういう場所に出てくるとこの市民から集中砲火を浴びるかもしれないというような考えを持つ人が多くて、それなかなかこういうところに出てくる。だから本来でしたらここで喋るべきはもう記者とかディレクター、いろんな放送メディアの局の人が本来なら僕は喋るべきなんですけれども、それがこうできないというところにこの日本のメディア の弱さというのがもう象徴的に現れてるんじゃないかというふうに思います。
I believe that the problem lies, as has been said repeatedly, within the companies. It's first of all, even before one goes out and has these public meetings or press conferences, what needs to be done is to have meetings within the company, within the department. And I think probably the labor unions also need to take a stand and discuss these different issues. I'm showing this book, which I have referred to often in my career. It's by something called the Media Comprehensive Research Center. It's important for every journalist to basically study the past, study history, see what kind of battles have been fought in the past. And when you look back and see the different incidents that occurred in the 1960s and 1970s, you learn that there were reporters and directors and labor unions who fought back against people who tried to hold them down. Sometimes they were unsuccessful, but they still had the energy and vitality to fight back. Nowadays, however, thinking within companies, media companies, is to always look inward. They don't want to go out and fight. They don't even want to go out and meet average people on the streets and exchange opinions. They don't want to have public discussion forums. They always wanted to discuss within themselves, among themselves, within the company, how to possibly avoid criticism, how to basically not become targets for attacks. And I think, therefore, as a result, there are very few people who are willing to come and sit in a public venue like this. And as you have pointed out, as the lady has pointed out earlier, it should not be people like us that are sitting here. It should be actually the people who come from different large media organizations. It should be reporters. It should be directors. It should be members of maybe labor unions who should be out here speaking, but they can't. That is probably the most fundamental weakness and the reason for the fundamental weakness of the Japanese media.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Fujita-san.
フリーランスのジャーナリストの藤田と申します。夕刊フジとかに書いております。ちょっと今日のですねお話で私は実は言うとびっくりしたんですが、例えばその自民党なんかはですねやっぱり支持者多いんですね、与党ですから。そうするとテレビ見ててですね、例えば安倍政権の自民党の意見を応援している人たちとかね、あるいは沖縄で辺野古に移転に賛成している人たち、これ半分近くいるんですね、沖縄にね、そういう人たちね、から見るとどうもテレビ見てると我々の意見が報道されてないなという印象を受けるんですよ。でそれを放送法で見てみると、こう今日出てますけどね、4条の2項とか4項、4条の2項、放送についてはですね、政治的に公平であることとかですね、4項は意見が対立している問題についてはできるだけ多くの角度から論点を明らかにすることと書いてる、これとちょっと違うじゃないかという意見があるんです。その辺どうお考えですか？
I would like to express great surprise at some of the things that you've been saying today. For example, the facts of the matter are that the LDP is basically the ruling party because they have the majority of people, citizens, supporting them. However, when we see different things that the LDP is trying to present, or when, for example, there are articles or features about Okinawa, the U.S. Marine base to Henoko is a decision that is supported by nearly half of the people of Okinawa. In other words, there are many, many people, the majority perhaps of the people are basically on the side of the government or the ruling parties. However, when we watch television, it seems that our opinions or our viewpoints are almost never reflected. This seems to go against the fundamental tenets of the Broadcasting Law or the Broadcast Act, specifically Article 4, Clause 2 and 4. Clause 2 says basically you must be politically fair in your broadcast. And number four says that you must try to present, as if there is an issue that is highly controversial, then you must do your best to try to present as many diverse opinions and viewpoints as possible. I don't think this is being done. How do you respond?
まさにですね、これは放送法ができた時からこの規定に罰則がないんですね。倫理規定なんです。
First of all, I'd like to point out that this has been something that has been contended since the Broadcast Act or Broadcasting Law was established. One thing that is very clear is that this is not something that is subjected to a fine or a penalty if one does not abide by these principles. This is basically a fundamental fundamental ethical or moral principles by which broadcasters need to act.
なぜならば、放送法という法律は表現の自由というのがベースにあります。
In other words, these are fundamental principles that need to be respected is what the broadcast law is about. And the broadcast law is basically predicated on the important human right, which is the freedom of expression.
さらに国に対して民主主義の発展というのを求めています。
It also very clearly states that there is a mission that is entrusted to the government, which is that it must do its best to ensure that democracy grows and thrives in society.
したがってこの4条の条文だけ読むと、その政治的に公平であるとか、論点の多角的提示というようなことがありますけれども、それはあくまでも放送事業者が表現の自由とか民主主義の発展というベースの中で、そういう気持ちでやってくださいねということであって、それを違反する、違反しないという議論になること自体が、やはり萎縮効果を招いてしまうということなんですね。
So if you look only at the wording of the, this law, and if you look at Article 4, as you've just described, it looks as though that broadcasters must do certain things, that they must be politically fair, they must present diverse opinions. However, again, what is more fundamental is the constitutional right for freedom of expression that serves as the basis of this broadcasting law. And it also, there is this fundamental idea that democracy must be enhanced.And must be allowed to thrive. So basically, the broadcast law is our principles that are presented to broadcasters to keep in their hearts. And it is with these ideas that they should conduct their business, is the fundamental idea behind this broadcasting law. So nothing in the broadcasting law is subject to a criticism that one violates the broadcast law or one does not follow the broadcast law and therefore is subjected to a penalty.
かつて政治的公平を守る番組として、国会の議席数に応じて各政党の議員の発言を縛った番組がありましたが、それがいかに馬鹿げているかっていうのの証明だと思います。
In the past, there was an attempt to literally take some of these principles and realize them. For example, there was a political program where it was decided that representatives from the parliament, the Diet, would appear in the program, but the number of members that would appear from each party would depend on the number of seats that each party had within the Diet. But obviously, this was a very, very silly way to construct a program, and it disappeared very, very quickly.
Okay, the honorable last, very last question goes to the ambassador.
Khalil Hassan, honorary member, I'm very impressed by the discussion. Money, deregulation, privatization, globalization, social networking changed media. And the media independence, again, the technology is changing. My question to you, how we should redefine media independence and what sort of law, global law should be there? Thank you, sir.
はい、皆様のお話に、を聞いて非常にインプレス、されております。今世界がどんどん変わってきているわけでございます。規制もどんどん緩和されておりますし、民営化、あるいはグローバル化、またソーシャルメディアの発達など、どんどんどんどんメディアの世界というものが変わってきているかと思うんでございます。メディアの世界が変わってきておりますので、その、いろんなその用語、ターミノロジー、専門用語ですか、定義というのも変わってくるんだと思うんでございます。私の質問なんでございますが、これからは独立したメディアの独立性、というのをどうやって、確保すべきだと思いますでしょうか、ね、それを確保するためにどういうような手続き、枠組み、など、行動などが必要だと思いますでしょうか。
はい、一つは教育だと思います。
I think one important thing to keep in mind is education. Education is very important.
それは若者に対する、教育。つまり民主主義というのもそうですし、フリーダムもそうですし、 それから何よりコミュニケーション、相手を傷つけるということはどういうことかということをきちんと教えないと、インターネット上では非常にトラブルが起こりやすいと思います。
I think in the future education, when we talk about the future of media, I think the education of young people is very, very important. We need to, of course, teach them about the importance of democracy, the importance of freedom, and we also need to teach them about the importance of proper communication. It's because young people do not necessarily understand, not just young people, but many people do not necessarily understand that it is possible through communication to hurt, wound people, that you see many terrible things appearing on the internet.
もう一つ教育が必要なのは権力者ですね。
Also another thing that education needs are people of power, people in power.
私は6月に、自民党 の, 部会の中でとんでもないメディアを潰せとかですね、広告をやめろとかっていう発言が出たときに、読売新聞という新聞に、自民党こそ教育研修をちゃんとすべきっていうコラムを書きました。
In June of this year, when there was this incident where there were press incidents where the subcommittee within the LDP had a meeting and they were discussing ways to basically crush the media if necessary, and the best way to crush the media or hold down the media would be to cut off their revenue sources, in other words, to cut off their advertising revenues. During that time in June, I wrote an opinion column, an article in the Yomiuri newspaper saying that what is first necessary is to have an educational seminar, educational session class within the LDP.
つまり今この国の権力を持っている人たちが自由とか民主っていうことが分かっていないので、そういう権力者がグローバルになっていくと非常に困るからですね。
What I'm saying is that the people who now have great power, people in powers in positions of great authority, do not fundamentally understand what freedom is, what democracy is. And as these people grow and evolve, for them to play a major role on the world stage is going to be even more problematic.
グローバル化はこれからどんどん進んでいくと思いますが、ある意味人間の歴史っていうのは言論弾圧の歴史でもあるので、それをきちんと学んで、これからどうやって、このインターネットの時代っていうのを作っていくかっていう、そういう意味でも教育が非常に大事だと思っています。
So I believe that globalization will only continue to accelerate in the future, and when we look backwards at human history, the history of human beings has been a history of more and more suppression of free opinion, of suppression of expression. So it is only by educating the people who are in positions of power and people who will eventually becomePeople in positions of power about the mistakes of the past that you will be able to try to ensure that the age of the internet will not face a similar path.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Thank you for staying extra time for such an important issue as this. Again, you know, when the freedom of press is really lost, we probably will not know that it's been lost because there will be no media to report it.So that's why it really touched upon the fundamental value of democracy and human rights. Anyway, please give a very big applause to our speakers today. And thank you for coming to the press conference. The speakers will stay around to exchange meishi, if you will.